on this planet over the life cycle of buildings, not just for construction, of course, but for usage. And you can see the others. So there are other figures here. So any difference we can make here, even if it's a tiny one, makes a big difference globally, and that's what we're setting out to do. And the company, a company globally active like LafargeHolcim, is truly committed to sustainability. So it made sense in 2003 to initiate this foundation for sustainable construction, to underline this commitment to sustainable development, something that is also in the core value of this company. Sustainability all the way along, of course, not just standing out in the world and finger-pointing at others, you have to be sustainable. It's a lot of homework for the whole company at the same time as well, to live up to it with products in the way that they behave, in the way they produce, and so on. And the last comment regarding LafargeHolcim as a company is that they have a 2030 plan in that's working an ambition that says that they want to lead by innovation. Innovation in all ways of building material, and generate one-third of revenue by 2030 out of products and services that are related to sustainability. So it's more than this commitment, it's really something one-to-one that is happening. And with that, I'd like to come back to sustainable construction as a word. If I were to ask any of you in here, what is sustainable construction, I'd probably get as many answers as you are in the room. Because it has to do with everything. Of course, it's about long-lasting, it's about saving energy, it's about using less land, better material, local material, and. But it's all that together. So what we're trying with this foundation for sustainable construction is to promote a holistic view of construction, incorporating all elements of sustainability. You've got in this sentence you can see here embedded the definition of sustainability per se, meaning that we should not behave and use raw material or build in a way that would hinder our kids and their kids to lead a life at least as good as we can. We cannot use all the resources, we cannot use all the land, we have to think ahead. And in order to make this a little bit more tangible, we developed five so-called target issues for sustainable construction. And that is more or less the basis of everything this foundation does, and it's also the criteria for the competition. And this is based, on the one hand side, on the three elements of the triple bottom line. Being balancing issues related to social issues, related to people, environmental issues, related to the planet we're on, and economic issues related to prosperity, that we can move ahead, bringing them into some kind of balance and achieving by doing that sustainability in the center. So these five target issues, of course there's much more to each of these, I'll be talking about it, but this in short, what you see here, represents the triple bottom line, people, planet, prosperity, plus, of course, place, space, because we're talking of something we are realizing in the built environment. So it's the contextual, the aesthetic impact of something that has been put there that has to be in a balance too. And maybe most important of all, it's about innovation and about transferability. If you cannot transfer something from one place to another, you can also be looking how did, for example, our ancestors build? What did they do to survive before there was air conditioning? They had ways to build for natural ventilation, but it still worked today because the wind is still the same. So I think it's going along there. So these target issues looking ahead, progress, people, planet, prosperity, and the contextual environment. That's what we're actually looking at when we talk about sustainable construction. This foundation has a number of activities. I'm not going into the details. There are events, academic events, there are publications, there are round tables, but the thing we're going to talk about today are the awards competition. Now, of course, LafargeHolcim couldn't this start and say, okay, we're going to talk about sustainable construction, because there wasn't that knowledge there from a building materials producer. So on the one hand side, we set together a board of specialists. These are the people who are now on the board. Of course, this changes every few years. Being people like Mohamed Yunus on this board, have been the former German environmental minister, people like that who have helped us to build up this foundation. And on the other hand, we cooperate with some you will spot, of course, that's where our eye goes first, where you live, that AEC is one of these universities in our network that support us in taking the message out, supports us in promoting sustainable construction because, as you've just heard before, it belongs to their DNI as well. This competition started in 2004-05. You can see, in the meantime, we receive about 6,000 and something entries, of which about 2,000 odd are valid and make it to the juries in five different regions of the world. It's actually five competitions in parallel that take place, and they also get judged in each region. So the fifth competition is open at the moment for projects, as I mentioned before, projects at an advanced stage of design, but before they've started building, mostly, and especially for people who are younger than 30 years of age for visionary ideas in sustainable construction. So there are two categories, I'll be talking about that. There are 59 prizes at stake, $2 million. You can see each region has a series of prizes that are going to be handed over again in about a year from now, and then there's a global phase of the competition that comes afterwards. The juries, as I said, are local, so we try to have really entries from a geographical region, like here now from Middle East Africa, that are looked at together and measured against each other in the regional phase. And I'm happy to know that Dr. Nawawy, who's going to head our jury, is in the audience today, and you will certainly recognize in one or the other name of the people who are on this jury. This also goes to show that the competition is independent of the sponsor. You will find one person on here from LafargeHolcim Research, from the research center in France, but that's mainly because somebody has to pay for dinner when they have their meetings. Back to the target issues. I'd just like to take an example project to show you what these target issues are actually about. And this take a gold-winning project, the one from 2012. I'll be showing you the ones from 2015 a little bit later on. From 2012, this was a school built in Burkina Faso by the architect Francis Kierre, who actually has a practice in Berlin, but he is from this village of Gondo where the school was built. You can see him here with the gold prize. I'll just go very quickly through these target issues. This just should give you a feel of it, but you have to, of course, also see that there won't be many projects that will live up to every target issue 100%, of course not. The idea of all the submitted projects is living up to each target issue as well as possible, and then it's a matter of judging by the juries if they think it has potential or not. So in this special case, what was really innovative and transferable about it? Mainly, it was the cooling, the natural cooling. You have to imagine that this school stands in an environment where there is no electricity and no running water. It's out in nowhere in a landlocked country. It's a school for 1,000 kids, primary school. So what he did here was mainly this, and I'm just taking out one example, cooling the air in a natural way by having a bit of some plants that where the air goes through, keeping those plants moisture, and then on top of it, leading the air under the ground, you can see that like little tunnel, and taking old clay pots and putting them in the earth with little holes in the bottom, so that you can pour water in the morning and the water dribbles through into the air during the whole day. Now you have said there's no water. So it's also an educational idea behind it. The kids have to take it in turns to bring water to school from a fountain or from a river in order to have a cool classroom. The difference that all that it's like 50 and above, that makes a big difference for your school. The other innovative factor was just lying around, but treated it as if it were concrete. He made a cast for elements, you can see, out of elements of rammed earth in a way, but he makes it fluid and then keeps it here. What you of course have to do is you need a little bit of concrete at the bottom that it doesn't suck up the water, and you need something on top as well, and you have to protect it against direct rain, otherwise it will wash out. Talking of people, of course, a school is anyway good. That's something where there was no school and you have a school that's undisputed anyway. That is something that makes the difference, and you can see here in this picture that the need for school was so big that they started using it before it was finished. And it's also a way of including the whole community, because these parents who never went to school want to enable their kids to go to school, so they were all helping. So the whole school was built only by the local villagers, instructed by one person, and with the prize money of the competition for the things that they had to buy. This is, for example, doing the floors inside in a very traditional way, this banging the floor, as they always made floors. That's how all the floors in this school have been made. If we talk of planet and materiality, it was a matter of going down to the river to fetch stones to make the foundation of the walls. You can see it here, this is the way that the foundations were laid. All handwork by the people there. Here you can see how they're mixing the earth with a tiny bit of cement and water that they have to carry there again. It's mixed by hand. The mixer itself is turned by hand, and then they pour it, they cast it into these things in the background. Talking of economy, it was a matter again of getting the people involved. So this architect, who happens also to be the chief of the village, I must say, asked the people to bring along used pots again. I told you one he needed for the water to go into the air, and the other he needed for something else. He needed it for the library. He wanted to make a library on this premises with natural light, natural ventilation, as easy as possible. So what you see on the roof here are cut apart clay pots. And the effect in the end is that you have fantastic lighting in a room, and you have natural ventilation at the same time. And this is now the library. And finally, this goes to show that even if you build cheaply, even if you build with natural material that's this there, even if you let the villagers build, you can make something that looks decent. Of course, the roof is the thing that had to be bought. That's really important, because you can't have direct water hitting. This is a different school room, but you can see the beautiful way that it was finished also inside. So with that, I just wanted to show you briefly what these target issues are about. And I'd like to run you through that you don't have the impression this is a competition for projects made of cob in landlocked African countries. Of the winners of the regional competition 3 years ago, where we had the ceremony in Beirut. So we had in the next generation things like fantasy things. This was a concept to use waste and produce electricity at the same time in Beirut. Or this one, this was textile production, bringing work spaces out to Pretoria, where there's too little work for workers at the moment in South Africa. Or this is a memorial site, an archaeological site in Ogaden, remembering the big earthquake that they had there. Or this was an idea for a water research center, again in South Africa, something very futuristic, as you can see, but it's about the ideas and the elements of sustainability which are in these projects. The acknowledgement prizes, there was one that went to a women's center in Palestine. There was one that went to, actually it's a radio station, this community building, that is resistant to flooding because it goes up and down with the tide in Nigeria. There was an idea for community farming and having a market where people could make a living by selling their things in Kigali, in Rwanda. Or there was this facade showing that even if you have higher buildings in tropical areas, that you can create facades that protect against the hot inside and enable certain ventilation. This was from Ethiopia. Then there was a project in Mauritania that was a more provisional kind of housing for refugees and a health center and school in this camp. Or there was another one in Ethiopia. This is a house that can be built in 3 days. It's a little bit like building Lego with pieces you put together, and then you can extend it. You build first the top floor, and when you've got more money or more children, you build the bottom floor as well. And this is showing that it doesn't always have to be something that is really built over ground. This was a project to redo the whole park, this lawn, this green lawn in Beirut, that was totally out of order since the war, and it's now getting rehabilitated thanks to this project. And then finally, the Gold Award. This was a project in Turkey for a technical hub with low-tech, high-tech kind of hub. An interesting building to respect very much the environment. This to give you a sort of an idea how broad this is. And in the second part, when I come up here again, I'll tell you how easy it is to participate in this competition. It's all online. So it's really easy, simple to do, and for everybody. And with this, I'd just like to sort of build myself a bridge to talk about another event that we do. These are academic events for experts from all over the world. This is done every 3 years, dedicated to a topic relevant to sustainable construction. You can see the topics we've looked at so far and where they took place on this slide. But the interesting thing, of course, is that we're really proud that the next one is going to be about rematerializing construction, is going to be hosted by AUC in Cairo in 2019. So we're going really around the world, as you can see here. These are big events, over 300 participants, usually from all over the world. This was the one in Detroit earlier this year, infrastructure space with a lot of keynotes, panels, discussions, workshops, indoors, workshops, outdoors. It was, of course, very thankful to do that in Detroit, where there's really a lot to look at with regard to infrastructure. And always what goes with these forums is that we have a competition for students that get invited to participate. Students that get nominated by our partner universities around the globe to come and exhibit a project that is relevant to the topic of the forum. And they, of course, get to discuss these projects with the people that write the books that they usually have to read at university. So it's an exchange in very, very many ways. And I'm really proud to have the winner of our last competition here with us. You can see in the bottom right-hand corner in the middle. laughing into the camera, Eduardo Pizarro, who actually today also made his first experiences with the local environment of Cairo, and as you can see at the bottom right, became a photo star of all the girls that happened to be out of the pyramid this morning as well. And with that, I'd like to hand over to Eduardo.
More soft for me to start a presentation. So, first of all, good evening, everyone. It's been a great pleasure to be here. So, thank you for this opportunity to share these ideas with you. And mostly with you, all like young professionals, it's a great pleasure. So, I'm here basically to show you briefly my master research, which finished as a project. It was awarded, as Edward just said, in the student poster competition. And the design starts with this context. Do anyone here have been to Brazil? Anyone in Brazil have been to Brazil? No? Oh, one, good. You should all go. You know, I came here and now it's our time to go, okay? Do we have a deal? Hopefully. Okay, so this is the context. We start in a country where 11 million people live in informal settlements. So, for you to have a scale, 11 million people is equivalent of the population of the biggest city in the country, which is São Paulo, as you can see here. And in São Paulo context, we have the second biggest favela, which is called Paraisópolis. Paraisópolis, if you translate directly, is city of paradise. So we can start arguing about it, perhaps it is, perhaps it's not. So let's discuss it later. And Paraisópolis is a big community with around 100,000 inhabitants. So it's a kind of a city, an informal city. I'm going to show you, this is Paraisópolis seen from the top. Can you see here? There is a grid. So this grid, the zirconal grid, was here before the favela started growing up. So it was pretended to be a formal settlement, but it didn't happen like this. So after that started the informal occupation. So because of that, we have two main different situations. We have the urban situation alongside the street, like here, yeah. And inside each block, we have what we used to feel like a favela, like the informal settlement. So this is the urban texture of Paraisópolis. We start looking for the materials, or the openings, the floors. Here it's a flat image, so we cannot see what happens in between the buildings, but it's gonna come soon. And for example, this picture was taken on the street. So it's a kind of really consolidated situation. We have the cars passing by, people, different levels, commercial use on the ground. And this could be any outskirts of São Paulo. This is very, very common and very consolidated. On the other hand, we have this kind of situation, which is inside each block. So we have these urban alleys and lanes that go darker or lighter, narrow or wider, and with different uses, different textures, and also in different levels. And the sidewalks are also very interesting in the favela because they are not used for people to walk. They're used as an extra space for different opportunities. So this should be taken into account for the design. There are also some infrastructure shortages, like electricity, sewage, and water. It's important to understand, I believe that here you have this also, self-construction is very important, it's needed. These people build the whole city and of course their own houses. Verticalization is also fundamental for the process of growing up the community. And let's not forget about inhabitants, because the research and design doesn't look for people as numbers. People are people, so that's how to deal with it. Okay, so from this context, the premises of the design are, first one, the favelas in São Paulo nowadays are a consolidated reality. So we cannot hide it, we cannot remove it, we have to deal with it. And second, inside the favela, the open spaces, so the spaces in between the buildings, have lots of shortages and conflicts, but at the same time, they have lots of potentialities and latent opportunities. From these, the design looks for the spaces in between the buildings. And here, you can see some images during the process, because as you know, the spaces in between the buildings are invisible. We cannot see, we cannot touch, it's immaterial. So how to analyze and design something that we cannot really understand? So the first effort of the design was to bring materiality to this urban void in drawings and 3D models, 3D fabrication as well, to understand the object and its potential as a network, as infrastructure. So the goal, the main goal of the design is to requalify the second biggest informal settlement in São Paulo through the redesign of the spaces in between the buildings. I'd like to highlight just a few steps, just a few points of the method. So here you can see a tripod that organizes the research. So we have environmental, urban, and social domains, all of them looking and tackling issues for the city and for the urban dealers. It was very important, the fieldwork, so the design and the research was made on the ground, looking for the people, and seeing this as a design research, so it's a way to propose something to the real territory at the same time that we made research. The method starts basically after some theoretical background with fieldwork. So in fieldwork, there are different scales from urban to indoor spaces. And basically I talk with people on the streets, I took some pictures, made some drawings, and also took some environmental measures. I'd like to highlight when I just started the fieldwork, I went with a camera, taking pictures, but then I saw, I understand that I was feeling like in a safari, like in a zoo. So I was putting myself so far from the community. So I thought that it would be much more kind and effective to do it by hand. So the drawings are the biggest tool to understand this place. And what I saw on fieldwork, the conflicts and potentialities, mostly I would say that the roads are too exposed, so they are too hot, they are not very secure for people to circulate. At the same time, on the other hand, the alleys and lanes are protected, but they are not healthy, so the houses are not healthy if we have these different issues altogether. From the fieldwork, from the conflicts and potentialities, I go to analytical work where I can measure the impact of different strategies to qualify this territory, and then after this, transform this strategy in design. So you can see here some simulations. I used some softwares for this. So for understanding the natural ventilation, the urban flow, how to pass through the urban fabric, and also how the light goes inside, so do we have any places that are really shadow or not. And also during analytical work, it was very nice to simulate how could I enhance the environmental quality of the houses just changing one facade. So during analytical work, I could find numbers that could base, in which I could base my design. So it's really environmental driven and based on. I didn't make really a participatory process. Using this word would be kind of dangerous, but I was looking for a participatory process. And how did I do that? I did some workshops with children, so we went for talkings and then we made some drawings. And here you can see on the bottom here, they made a lot of drawings. It's a paper shared in the middle. So on the left, they draw the city they live in. And on the left, they draw the city they would like to live in, the city they dream with. So it was very important to understand how people relate to their place and what do they expect for its future. So from these different steps, we have finally designed as a research tool. The results are the strategies that I organized as four main strategies. The first one is more urban scale, and it's based on an understanding that I took on the ground. Here is basically a collage for you to understand how it works, the verticalization inside the favela. So when you have any other space left on the ground, how it grows up. We start with one floor, you have a corridor, electrical corridor, and then you have a garage, and then your family goes bigger, so you have the first pavement. And then you have to make money, and we go to the third step, when you change the garage into a commercial use for yourself, or for you can rent this space for anyone else. And then the family goes bigger again, you have another floor, and then you can go to the rooftop where you can have different uses as hanging clothes or have a barbecue and things like that. So from this understanding of the ground, what happened is, this is a real case. So it's a whole building with these different floors. On the first floor, here in yellow, lives Maria. On the other floor, lives her ex-husband. On the ground floor, you're seeing everything, you know, that's finished. Okay, let's go back. On the ground floor, there is a commercial use that was rent as well, and on the rooftop, they sold the rooftop to anyone else. So, from this, what I thought, each floor of each building has an independent property, independent access, independent materials, independent functions. So instead of looking to the favela, the minimal unit of the favela, as the building itself of the built interval, why not to see the minimal unit as each floor? So then we can have a more kind and effective approach to this problem. And of course, it's important to have some structural enhancement and so on. But anyway, from this, we could have this situation, 3 floors to 4 or 5 floors. In green, you can see this in between, so the alleys and lanes. From this situation, we could maintain the same people, the same amount of people living here, but redesigning what's in between. So then we allow the wind to permeate, we allow the sun to come, and also we create different urban spaces in different levels with connections, with perspectives and landscape. And here I will start with some drawings. So that's good to see. So the drawings show how the technical background turned into design. Here you can see some sections of the roads, understanding how the access to the sun was so important to determine the building mass and the spaces in between the buildings. I'm not going very accurately about each of the sections, we can talk about it later, but this is a bigger drawing, this is just a section of it, for you to see this different shows that are happening. So we are reopening this space for people and in a way that you have a better environment inside and outside. Here you can see, for example, if I want to have sun here, this is an important place, it's a public and collective space, so we can have this solar access, this natural ventilation with different uses and different levels. Here the same thing about the street, so how to bring things that already exist on the territory and also articulate everything to create infrastructure. The second strategy is focused on the facades. So at the same time that I talk about the in-between, it's very important to know about the interface between inside and outside, which is the facade. The question was, how to guarantee environmental quality inside the buildings at the same time that this facade promote and invite people to have urban uses outside. So this was the biggest effort on this design. And I started designing these facades as we architects like using, like this Bristol Lake. So these sunbreakers. So I saw all different orientations, different levels, should have different Bristol Lake and so on. But then I started arguing, what's the cost of implementing this on the favela, what's the cost of maintenance? And then I thought, why not could we use an ordinary material that they use every day to build their houses, but informed environmentally? That's when I started studying the use of different blocks, like concrete blocks or ceramic blocks with different assemblages, to provide different environmental, social, and urban qualities. So here you can see you have like a bench that can be a bus stop or a place for people to stay, or you can chat between the gaps. At the same time that you have natural ventilation, you have solar protection. This is mostly focused on places that can have natural ventilation, or you have another layer that protects you during winter and so on, maybe rain as well. So we have different situations here. And this drawing shows, for example, sometimes we don't really need to change the facade to have environmental quality outdoors and indoors. Sometimes just a tree is enough. So if you have space, why not a tree on that space to create another environment? And here, these are some, can you see here, it's a kind of big Bristol lace to protect for during summer. But it's not just, perhaps the environmental quality is not the biggest goal of this structure. It's more creating a support, creating a materiality for people to appropriate that support. So, as I said before, it could be a bus stop, a bench, a place for advertisement, or just to stay, hang out. And this is always related with adaptability. So, the users have to know what they need, and this need changes, so this has to change, and the support has to be adaptable. So, and here again, when we redesign these spaces in between, we could also have this auto shading, as you can see here. So we have to bring all together the different strategies, the facades and the redesign of the spaces between the buildings to create the whole environment, the facades inside and outside. The third strategy is focused on the streets. So we have these nowadays. It's a kind of, they import to the informal territory some formal aspects. So we have the cars lane, and separately you have the sidewalk. And what happened is, as I said, everyone uses the road. So cars, bicycles, people, everyone. There's a logic that people walk together with cars. And then the sidewalk is a place and an extra space for a stair or for commercial uses. But then we could think, how could this be different? And then we have different skills to address these issues. So we start to create one level without these interruptions between sidewalk and road lanes, and we just leave the space for people to adapt. For example, here you can see the like an urban fair here. This already exists nowadays in the city in general, in the favela, but we could, the design should create a better invitation and a better support for these activities. So it's creating support to invite people to use and adapt and appropriate with quality always. And this is another possibility that can be done. So the last strategy is, here I'll show you a drawing of Mali, which was requalified, trying to take advantage of small practices, small opportunities that already exist on the territory, and how to bring them to life in a structural way. Here you can see, perhaps I can give some zoom in, yes. You can see reuse of water, rainwater collection, you can have shading of trees, small public equipment, other equipment as a bench that can be folded and unfolded by people in different moments. You have the rooftops that connect one to each other by view, and also urban art in different situations. And here, this other part of the drawing shows, here you can see, you can see how it's important to maintain the adaptability. So here, there's someone with an umbrella, so if it's hot, even nowadays outside, you can just open an umbrella and then you are feeling better. That's what we need. At the same time, we need to have some other strategies as a temporary structure, like this one that could be here, could be done by the dealers with simple textiles. Or even, this is a fountain. It doesn't mean that the design has to have a fountain. I'd like to say that if the community, if the neighborhood feels that they need a fountain, you know, for to refresh, or to have a meeting point, or to have an identity to say, oh, find me on my alley, the alley of the fountain. So this is very important to take into account for the design. At the same time, we have urban agriculture, on the rooftops, on the facades, different uses, colors. This is all bringing brought together in a different way to create a better environment for these people. And I'd like to finish, it's hard to say I'm finishing, you know, this is an endless process. We cannot say that this design is finished, it's never finished. But during the, as a conclusion to finish, like it's for this talk, during my research, my design, I talk with different people from different places, different backgrounds. And then one of the questions I did was, how could you define favela in just one word? It's tough. Yeah, I believe that here if we ask you, we would have different answers. But for me to finish, I'll give my answer to this question. I don't want to be romantic, but I do believe that despite the shortages, despite the conflicts, us architects have a great role and a great opportunity to look to the informal places and find lessons to bring and discuss the whole city. So we won't see anymore this favela apart from the city. So how to bring together and how to take the lessons to discuss and redesign another future for the whole city. That's it, thank you.
To see a little bit deeper into it, to get an impression of what this is all about and in which direction that we're going. And I'd like to take at least one step further and make you comfortable with the three projects that got the last Global LafargeHolcim Awards. This that you have an idea again, and keep in mind again these target issues. They were all measured against these five target issues and stood out. I'm going to start with the Global Bronze. That's a project by the Arcables, BIG, in Manhattan, in New York. And I'd like to underline this with a video that they produced. Now we'll try it.
I think the sheer magnitude of it caught a lot of people off guard.
They're like saying anything with an unprepared ball, not even the slightest. Yeah, with like an invasion of water. And not a big kind of boat.
So yeah, I mean, it came right on top of it. There was literally boats on 14th Street floating in the water.
We have a sub-basement level office as well. And it was totally covered in water for 2 days. So we lost everything.
This is a project to protect Manhattan against water without this building wall around it. You saw there are a lot of interventions, ways of creating public space at the same time, usable space that at the same time acts as a barrier against water, as you can see here on these drawings too. They've started building this already, and it's going the first part of it on the east side. Is going to be finished in 18. There are billions going into it from the federal state, so it's a really interesting project. So that was the bronze winning one, and now I'd This is the one that in the end won a global prize. But this, the way that you're going to see it now, it was entered into the regional competition Asia Pacific and got the bronze prize. So I'd just like to show you what this project is about without going any further. Let's hope that this video will work.
This project aims to reintegrate former soldiers of government and rebel forces into post-war Sri Lankan society. The young men are trained in building techniques through their involvement in the construction of public buildings, like, for example, the community library in Ambedkar. The stone building wraps around an inner courtyard and takes full advantage of cross ventilation and daylight. Round earth walls of recycled materials reduce the building's ecological footprint. The Holcim Awards jury commends the focus on the building process as well as on the building's physical artifact. Greatly appreciated is the project's vocational training aspect, which will contribute beyond the immediate task at hand to capacity building in a broader sense. The project aims collective wills, builds labor workforces, disseminates knowledge, fosters sustainable development, and strengthens social relations.
So this was how the project was entered. And in the meantime, the project actually got realized. And what maybe you didn't hear so much in this video is that this project is on a campus belonging to the army, and it's at the same time a project to train former soldiers that are not longer used in the army because the civil war is over, to learn something. They have been soldiers since they were young. They have to go back to their villages, and the idea is to train them in building skills so that they can go home and build houses and do something when they're out of the army. So that was the whole idea of this. This project, in the meantime, is actually completed, and I'd like to show you here this award ceremony itself. The award ceremony took place in the building itself, in the library that you can see on the bottom right-hand corner. And this is how it stands here today. And I'd like to show you on a video, again, what this is really working like and what it looks like at the moment.
I guess it's a bit like the radio station nearby, which is a former building. And the realization has given us a lot of clues on how to organize the building system-wise. But the thing is that the systems needed to be flexible and adaptable to tolerate different material possibilities as well as labor skills.
Before I show you that, I'd just like to show, to play you a very short excerpt of the jury report of the global jury related to this project. Why did the global jury finally decide to give this project the global gold top prize? Before it was built, they was only built actually after they got this prize. And in many cases, so also in this, the fact that a project gets a prize helps it very much to get realized. It's easier to find money and support in communities when something has got a global prize before. So I'd just like to give the word to Lafarge, who was the head of the jury.
The many project received the gold award because, considering all its attributes, all its qualities, it was thought to represent the best combination of architectural ideas, urban development, the contribution that we made to the quality of life of the citizens of Medellin. This combination, this idea of a project that operates at multiple scales, was something that ultimately, after many conversations, many discussions, stood up. One of the key attributes of the Medellin project is that it utilizes infrastructure, more specifically water infrastructure, as an element that then is utilized to go beyond its mere functionality as infrastructure, to become infrastructure as an element for public life, as an element for the pleasure of the citizens. And therefore, this transformation of everyday elements that we don't normally associate with social life, public life, is one of the things that we really have to think about in many parts of the world as we move forward with the ideas of what is public, what are public spaces. And
so this was the jury report on this project, and to finish off, I'd just like to show you what this project has turned into as it looks today. This is just a few months ago. After we gave the gold prize there, you can see Ms. Alejandro Araveno gave the prize to an event in the city. And this, if you remember the renderings, this is exactly how it was imagined to look, and this is exactly how it does look today. Remember the five target issues. Think of the innovation in it, the idea to multiply. This has already been multiplied about 12 times around the city in the meantime, because there are more old water stations that have, or water tanks that are not used anymore, that have been turned into public space. They were gated in before, they were locked in because people were afraid that somebody might do something to the water. It's opened up, it's creating space for the public while still using, you can see it in the background, some of these water reservoirs. This is the way it looks now. You've got a walking way along the top. You've got an amphitheater in the bottom. You've got public space here. You've got possibilities to have any kind of event, any kind of public event here. Inside, through very, very clever measures, you remember the rendering of this too, how the light is funneled into these rooms inside. How above you can see, for example, because there was no money around, these lighting things, those are actually old sewage pipes that have been cut into pieces, a little bit like in the project in Gondo, stuck into the ground, and they bring light down. What you see on the picture to the left is a bench to sit on, but actually on the backside, it's got an opening, also letting light into the bathrooms, as you can see it here on the left, and the tubes with the light you can see on the right in the passageway, so that there's natural lighting in there. And even here, if you try to do something in a very cheap and efficient way, you can still make nice architecture. You can really realize something meaningful for the community in the middle of the favela here too. You've got the playground for kids on top of it as well. It's all about water and light, as you heard. So with that, I think I've tried at least to give you an impression of how broad this competition is. Now, of course, of all these projects, because we're not looking to build things, but for projects, not everything gets built. So it's about half that gets built, and the other half stays an idea, goes into a draw, but at the same time is published on our website, is there for reference for other people to find good ideas. So the main idea of the foundation and of the awards is to promote the idea of sustainable construction, to be something like a hub for good ideas where you go and have a look, how did others do something, and work with it. We've had more than 200 prize-winning projects around the globe so far in these first four competitions, and now, as I mentioned, we're into the fifth in any case, and it's really easy. Two categories, as I mentioned earlier on, it makes no difference how big, how small a project is. It just has to live up to these target issues as well as possible. It may not have started production or execution or building before July 4 of this year. Anything that started building later is okay. And projects are allocated to the region where they should be built, not where the author lives. So it can be that an architect from Germany, like Francis Kering, has a project somewhere in Africa, so it counts in the region Africa, that it competes with similar projects there. Very important, everybody always asks me, does it cost something? No, of course not. It's open and free for everybody to participate. There are three project groups to make it a bit easier because the system will ask for different basic information depending on what the project is about. So one is for architecture, building, and civil engineering, where you'll probably get asked how many cubic meters, how many square meters, and things like that. Or when it's about landscape, urban design, infrastructure, there will be different criteria that count, that have to be entered with the competition. Or if it's to do with materials, products, or technologies, that's all possible as well. Of course, here there would be different criteria that are asked. And it's all online. You've got the address on the top of this slide here. It's just a normal form to fill in. You fill in everything as it asks for it. You put in photographs, captions, all the rest. And when you're finished, you get a PDF back, 4 pages, with all the information you entered, all the text you entered, all the images and captions you entered, and this is exactly what the jury gets to see, these 4 pages. So there's no hidden agenda. What you put in comes out, goes to the jury, and serves as basis for allocating the prizes. There's online too, there are step-by-step guides to download, short ones, long ones, there's really everything there. What I'd like to show you is, and this won't surprise any architect, engineer, and in any case not the students of those disciplines in the room, the competition is open until March 21. So our experience teaches us that we get 90% of all entries in the last 48 hours. I assume that will be the same this time, because otherwise we wouldn't be too satisfied with the number of entries yet. What you can see here is just the portions where the entries that by December 1 have been started in the system have come from. And I'm really pleased to see that Middle East Africa is number 2. So far, it's always been the weakest in all, so this is really great to know. And if you want to see some more details, I'll show you those too. This should be very motivating for everybody in Egypt, because you're not leading at the moment. You can see Algeria, Nigeria, and Iraq have all started entries, but this is only really the beginning. We know by experience that at the end there are going to be hundreds from all over, and I'd just like to motivate everybody in the room. Have you own project, or you know somebody who has a project, or you know somebody who knows somebody who has a project? Motivate them to enter into this competition. You can only win. At least what you'll have is a lovely PDF of your project at the end, Maximum you can have is a global gold prize and a couple of $100,000 more to do with what you like. Having said that, I'd like to also stress, and I'm really proud of this, that more than half of all entries in the last competition were from people younger than 38 years of age, and more than a third of all entries were from ladies who also won a big proportion of our prizes in the last competition. I was very pleased to see that today you see the percentage of people getting educated as architects is also more than half, so we're on the right way. With this, I'd like to close this session. I hope I was able to show you a little bit what it's about. Please keep this address in mind. Go and have a look also if you are interested in more information. Everything's there. And with that, I'd like to hand back to Dr. Khalid. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Eddie, for a fantastic presentation. I wish I'm as good as you, actually, in summarizing all of this in such a short time. And thank you, Eduardo, as well, for equally a very fantastic piece of work. And I will try to find an opportunity for our students to look at this work again. But before we go out to the refreshments and to see the exhibit, we have a short Q&A session where I will invite Ed and Eduardo and Dr. Nakwa, the head of the jury, in to talk about it. And before I do that, Dr. Nakwa, can you please? And Ed, Eduardo, I would like to again thank whomever made this event actually successful. I would like to start with Ms. Summer Roof, which she is actually the engine behind the success of this, and I thank Lafarge Asia for her support on this. What I thank, of course, is you and the army of individuals who have been helping us left and right to put this in a successful way. And thank you all, actually, for coming over. So let me start this by just asking Dr. Nagwa to comment on this, given the last slide that Eddie had about the percentage of females. So we are very proud to have you as the head of the jury, and would like you to talk a little bit about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Khalid. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Eduardo, for your presentations. I'm very pleased to welcome everybody to this session. It's very informative. And as Dr. Khalid mentioned, Samar was at the head of organizing all this. We thank her very much for doing all this. I'm just going to brief and recapitulate what has been said previously by Ed and Eduardo and Dr. Khalid. I'm very pleased to be at the head of the awards jury for the Middle East and Africa. I am looking forward, and I'm sure that we will get very interesting and creative, innovative entries from the region to be competitive with the global ones. And to recapitulate also is that I want to emphasize the fact that the entries can be from individual persons, from groups, from teams, larger teams or smaller teams. So everybody is welcome to enter. We encourage very much our professional society in Egypt, young architects, students, to make entries, and I'm sure we will have very creative and very ambitious ideas. And as we saw from the previous presentations, that the projects can be of very small scale, depending on the idea and how much it serves the community, and it serves the idea of sustainability. The idea of sustainability is an ongoing one. It's a crucial one. And for our developing countries, I think it is the only way out. So ideas, creative projects, that will be the name of the game. And good luck to all. Thank you.
Okay, so I just wanted to emphasize that if you have questions, and you would have questions, of course, we will go to digital, how can you submit what's going on after you read the website? You probably will have lots of inquiries. I am the country ambassador here in Egypt. I will be going to universities to talk about the competition, reaching out to you, maybe to your friends as well. You're free to answer or email questions to the foundation, but you're also welcome to email me personally. I have my business card, and I want to make sure that on your way out, that you pick up the flyers from the registration desk, that you have left your name for us, so that we can get a hold of you, and that you know quite well the web page address where you will be if you intend to join the competition. So with this said, do you have any closing comments and questions?
Are there any questions from the floor? If not, I would not like to speak anymore because I spoke a lot. If I may, I'd like to pass it on to Eduardo because he's not only a PhD candidate at the university in São Paulo, but also an ambassador of our awards. So after this question, I'd just like to pass it on to him to motivate, in particular, also the young generation to participate.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I do want to ask about the economics of the projects being presented. Is there a request or is there a requirement to speak about the project cost, especially with respect to the aspect of transferability and repeatability? Does also look at the economics, how much the project cost, the construction, when the judging.
Thank you, thanks, sorry, I can't hear it because the loudspeakers are in front, sorry. So if I got the question right, your question is whether in the project entry you have to include the price of it and how it's going to be financed and things. So if that is possible, yes, there is a point where you can estimate how not only how much it will cost, but also how you intend to have it financed, because there are also more original or less original ways of financing something. So more sustainable and less sustainable ways. So it's always a matter of giving as much information as you have. What you don't know, you can't give. And that is all taken into consideration while evaluating against the whole project. So you have to see that, of course, these members of the jury, they've all got a lot of experience. So they can more or less look at these things and tell, is this now out of the blue or is this not out of the blue? Is this realistic? Is this not realistic? But again, it's not the main purpose that a project really gets built. It's lovely if it does. But there are projects like a student project, you don't have a price to it because maybe most probably it won't get realized, but it's the idea then that counts. So it's very, very flexible as it is what you can enter, as flexible it is how you enter it. So any additional question?
Hello, my name is Ahmed. Thank you for your speech. It was a good speech, by the way. Now my question is, I'm a civil engineer. My background is a civil engineer. I have touched sustainability solutions and need requirements in the Zuwail City, in 6 October. It's a university, like the American University. But as a civil engineer, I wanted to know more about the need requirements. I want to study more, I want to research this myself. It was my first time to see the need requirements in this project. Now, is there a group in LinkedIn or a group in Facebook you can switch to research in lead or something like this? Thank you.
Okay, the question is directed to if you can, where can you learn about lead and all of that. I have the brochure outside for the American University Center for Sustainable Development as well as School of Sciences and Engineering. We have courses of training professionals for lead the green associates and the credit professional. So I'll be happy to share with you the link afterwards.
Yes, thank you. I'm not asking for courses, I'm asking for research from for Mr. Edward. Is there a research or something like this? You have a lot of researchers a background, like LinkedIn group or something like this.
Thanks for the question. This course not only LEAD, there are many other
LEAD or GRID.
There are BRIAN and all the Norwells, but we don't directly work with them. That is, of course, an organization. These are organizations that are organized in such a way that they give points for certain things that you do or don't do while you're building. And that qualifies then in the end. We heard one of the buildings here on campus of AUC. Got LEED certified. So it's not in our competition. That is totally outside. It's not a matter of having LEED points to get an award. It's really these target issues. But if you want more information, that's your question.
Yes.
You can get in touch with me and I can show you, I can send you some links. But otherwise, if you Google it, you'll find masses of discussion forums. You'll find it on every online portal. There are so many of them. And if you want to go a bit more neutral, go to the Green Building Councils. You heard that there's a Green Building Council here too. I'm sure they work with one of these organizations too. There's masses of it out in the net.
Yes, thank you. You are something. Thank you.
Any more questions? Okay, I just would like to add the last comment and I would leave the final word to Eduardo. As we noticed all that many of the issues that he mentioned in his presentation, whether it is the pedestrians walking in the streets with the cars, or many issues of the urban issues that he mentioned in Brazil, are very much similar to our region as well. So I would like to give him the word to just encourage our young architects to participate in such a competition because many of the issues are common and they can be dealt with. Whether it is on a very small scale, as a small project, or as an urban scale that what Eduardo has been doing.
Thank you. I believe it's very simple. As Eddie said before, there's no reason why not to apply. So that's the moment, that's a great opportunity. So LafargeHolcim creates this space for us to get in touch with the others doing other continents with the same issues. So we have this exposure, you have reassurance if you win the prize. So I can talk by my experience. I didn't get the awards. It was a student poster competition. But in my case, after this, my design project went like this, you know, widespread, worldwide and mostly in my country. So people sent me emails trying to know a bit more about it. And also it was open a door to bring this to reality perhaps. So this could have an answer to the community. So I really believe you should try, you should give a try for applying to the competition. That's the moment, that's the opportunity. And you saw the jury, you saw the people that are on the jury, you saw the winning projects, the people who won before. So that's it.
Well, thank you very much for your patience with us. and for participating in advance. And I invite you now to the reception outside, as well as to visit the both exhibits. We have two-part exhibit on the left side and the right side that I would like you to look before you. Thank you.